Well, good morning, Mr. Schamus.
Good morning, Lupe. How are you?
I'm good, but a bit devastated after watching Somos.
Yes, I'm sorry.
On Netflix. It was like, it was just stayed in my mind, like, what a horrible event. How did you hear about it? I'm sure I heard about it, but it's been 10 years, so I probably just put it in the back of my mind. So how did you hear about this?
You know, it has been reported and somewhat widely over the years, but really was still ignored at the same time, that weird paradox. I discovered the story through the reporting of Ginger Thompson from ProPublica, who's an incredible journalist and who created a kind of oral history with the voices of all these people in Allende. And once reading that, I didn't read it for the purposes of my business. I just was interested in the topic, but I realized it was a really unique way to enter into these stories of narco trafficking and the so-called war on drugs, and a way that didn't fall into the trap of romanticizing these narcos characters, but rather really looking at it from the point of view of the other people around. And that started the journey.
Now, did you fictionalize most of the people? But I'm sure you took accounts into the real accounts and then fictionalized it, right?
We did indeed decide, both myself and my writers, Monica Revilla and Fernando Melchor, very early on that we would fictionalize our characters in the town, mainly because we wanted to create, as we say, warts and all people. We wanted the fullness of these people. People who are victims aren't just victims, they're also people. You know, they have their own lives and stories, and that was our goal with the series. And so out of respect for the people who had spoken to Ginger Thompson and others, we decided to keep our folks fictional, but recognizable. If you're from Allende, you'll recognize in general the stories and the settings, but we hope you won't say, oh, that's so-and-so.
Yeah, and I was reading up on the ProPublica article about the massacre in 2011. They were saying a lot of the officials were involved and the police force. I mean, there's nothing new in Mexico. We know that, you know, everything is corrupt from, you know, high level to the bottom. But you were a little careful in showing that. Were you just focused on the Zetas? Or why did you go that way?
No, it's interesting. I know there's been, you know, there's like a journalist in Mexico who said, oh my God, they were so careful. They didn't show the Mexican government. But of course you've seen the series. I mean, the very first scene shows the agents of the Mexican state at the prison opening the doors for the narcos, the sicarios, right? And the very next scene, two scenes later, the guy says, oh, you know the governor. I've already called the army. Oh, watch out, don't talk to them. Throughout the whole series, we depict again and again the complicity of the Mexican state. But we also do something which I think is rarely done, which is show the structuring violence and complicity of the United States itself, which is always supposed to be the good guy in the so-called war on drugs, but clearly is not. So we wanted to keep that balance all the way through the end of the series, which as you recall, and it's a spoiler alert, but even at the very last sequence, our sicarios are driving through a police checkpoint, a military checkpoint, and they're like, hey guys, come on, no problem. So the idea that we went a little easy on the Mexican government seems, I think on retrospect, a tendentious argument. I don't understand why folks like Jacobo Dayan might make that, but that's it. You know, these are the things, that controversies that happen when you deal with these topics.
Well, no, but you see then that you focus on the DEA as well, how they were, well, I mean, the agent involved was trying to do his job, and of course the upper levels screwed it up because they let the Mexican federal agents know. And of course there's a leak. And so it's horrible. And then the manager, the top level guy is like, oh, well, that's what happens. Like, yeah, exactly. What an attitude, horrible attitude.
You do sense the power of that attitude, you know, even at the very end of the first episode, where we've taken our time to introduce you to all these beautiful people in the town. And of course, at the very end of the first episode, we zoom up to DEA headquarters and they're like, what's in Allende? And it's like, nothing. And this is the way they say that, there's a certain violence to it. Like, nothing, it's, you know, nothing. Ugh.
Well, how hard is it for you? I mean, it was beautifully done. The accents were right, because a lot of times when you watch something that was originates in America, you know, there's a viewpoint in Mexico, you can hear like the accents are all wrong. And, but I mean, this was beautifully done and all kinds of people from all walks of life are portrayed in here, which I really, really like, because you created this whole picture of what it's like to live in these towns where it's run by cartels.
Yeah. Yeah. The key, I think, to the success and the authenticity of the series is, believe it or not, my own ignorance and stupidity. This is not an international co-production. I did not fly down to Mexico with all of my key team members and department leaders. I didn't even bring an assistant. I decided to fly down and immerse myself as kind of the house idiot so that other people could empower themselves to really step up and participate in co-creating the series. And just like we, our main character is a chorus, it's a lot of people. The show is really created by an enormous number of genuine collaborators, many of whom are actually from the region. I think it's Matiales from Coahuila itself, many of our key crew and some of our cast. And everybody felt confident and comfortable to express themselves and contribute.
Now, do you speak Spanish or do you understand it? You know, what was it like being on the production when that was purely all Spanish? Well, there was some English.
It's been a journey. I started with not a word of Spanish, zero. And I'm terrible with languages, but I did. And it was good because the crew could get to know what an idiot I am because I took some intensive Spanish classes. Continuo a estudiar español.
Muy bien.
Muy bien. Duolingo, you see, maestra con internet. But I'm terrible. So I think it was good because the crew could see how bad I was and kind of make fun of me. And again, that I think made people more confident about stepping up and because it was very, it was a show that was brought out a lot of passion in people to tell the stories within it. And I felt that opened the door, you know, my own ignorance kind of opened the door for that.
Well, thank you so much for a beautiful series. I think a lot of people should watch this series just to know why people escape the towns like Central America, especially because of this, you know? So I think it's really well told. And I think people have a bit broader understanding of why people leave.
Yeah, and we are really, really proud of just how successful it's been already in Mexico. That was something, it's very different even for the Mexican, you know, mainstream audience. So the millions and millions and millions and millions of people who've now watched it there, we hope that that will, as they say, spill over the border too. We'll see. But to be honest, we made this for Mexico. And I'm so pleased with that response already.